track. And then I went to Louisiana College for a year, and I finished up in that little church for 3 years, and I decided it's now time for me to get serious about my theological training. And so Kathy and I went off to what was called Bethany Nazarene College, because I intended to go back to the Nazarene church. And so I went to Bethany Nazarene to tour the college and attend some classes, check some things out. But I'd heard about Oklahoma Wesleyan College, not far north of Oklahoma City, up in Bartlesville. And I said, honey, let's go check that out. And so we got in the car, and by then we have a six-month-old baby, and we go to Oklahoma Wesleyan just to check it out. I just heard things about it. I attended class and met some professors. And again, I thought, wow, they didn't plan for this, but I think, yeah, this might be where we're supposed to go. And so we wound up going to Oklahoma Wesleyan. And then I served a church. But I need to tell you this. While I was in Bartlesville, Oklahoma, I came from a big family, 8 kids in our family. And I don't mind telling you, I was the sissy of the family. 7 boys and a girl. I was the sissy. They called me a sissy. They all worked on cars, and they all hunted, and they all fished. They did all that stuff that I hated doing and didn't want to do. I'd rather go in my room and read. And so they'd catch me reading, and they'd say, what's wrong with you, boy? But anyhow, I couldn't fix anything. Never been mechanical a day in my life, but we go off to college, Kathy and I, and we have a six-month-old baby, and I didn't have a job either, and we move in, and silly me, I had like $250 in cash, and I thought, we'll have food, so I spent all of it on food, and I had one credit card that was already maxed out, and then I thought, I'm scared to death, what are we going to do? And so we had moved in on a Saturday, and we went to church the next morning at First Wesleyan, this big, big church in Bartlesville, and on Sunday night, we went back, and after church, we got in the car, and we were both so homesick already. We'd just gotten into Bartlesville the day before. We were homesick, and we were scared, and we didn't know anybody, didn't know how everything was going to work out. But I just truly, as a young kid, I trusted that God was going to take care of everything. But I wasn't sure he was. And I was scared. So after church, we drove downtown Bartlesville. Bartlesville, Oklahoma is a city of about, at least it was then, about 38,000. A little town, but it has this huge skyline, skyscrapers. Phillips Petroleum is located there. And there was a big fountain in the middle of the town. And we pushed the baby around the car. We walked and walked. And I'm fighting back tears because I've always been a baby. I was a mama's boy. And I'm homesick. And so we just walk around for a while. And then we go back to the car. And we get into this old car that I had. And it did nothing. Wouldn't make a sound, it wouldn't start. And folks, I want to tell you that all my life, my daddy or my older brothers, I called them if I had a problem, I needed something, especially at the car, because old sissy never worked on the car. I didn't want to get my hands greasy. And all of a sudden, I'm 525 miles from home. I can't call daddy. I can't call my older brothers. I don't have any money. And I got a six-month-old baby and a wife who are looking to me. And I said, well, honey, let me see if I can fix it. So I pop the hood and I go out and lift the hood up. And all I knew to do was bang on the battery cable. I've seen that before, you know. So I banged on the battery cable, got something banged on it, and back in, and I tried, and I cut it out, and I banged on it some more. And so then I got back in the car, and I said, it won't start. God, they said, I noticed that. And I remember this like it was yesterday. I sat and she said, what are we going to do? I said, I don't know yet. I really didn't know. I didn't know anybody. I just moved the day before there. And so what I did was I said, let me go try again. And so and by now, 30 minutes had passed by, I guess. I went back out, raised the hood, and I banged on the thing again. And then I started crying. I started praying. And I said, God, I just started out. I just knew this is what you wanted me to do. Was I foolish? I didn't prepare right. And I just, So I stayed for a long time until I didn't want Kathy to see me crying. And so I closed the hood, got back in the car, and I said, well, I think what we should do, we're about 3 miles from home. So we need to walk home, and tomorrow we'll figure out something. And so we put our little six-month-old in the stroller, and we started going towards home. And we got blocks down the street, and this man pulled up, and I recognized him because the moment I had first gotten out of the car and raised the hood, he was coming out of this big, big building, and he just looked at me, and I made eye contact with him, and he got in his car and left. And I see him and he says, hey, what, did you get the car started? I said, no. He said, let's go back and look at it. So I go back, and this is the story that he told me. He said, when I came out of work tonight, I was up in my office doing something. He said, I noticed you. And you had a wife and a baby in that car. And I thought, they're having troubles. And I went home. He said, I went straight home and I turned on the TV and I sat in my recliner. And he said, I heard this voice that said, you need to go check on those kids. And so he said, I felt like I was supposed to come back and check on you. And he pulls up and he tries to start it. He put his jumper cables on it and started up. And he went home. And I got home that night. And I felt the Lord was saying to me, I got this, boy. You're going to be okay. I got this. The next morning, I got a neighbor to jump me off, and I went to the service station, and I remember it was an Interstate battery, and it was a bad battery that I just bought a month earlier, and it was covered by warranty, so I got that new battery, and everything was fine, and I have tried to trust the Lord for the next 40 years. And it's been an awesome, awesome journey. And it's been a wonderful 40 years of ministry. But I have to tell you that the most fulfilling, the greatest ministry, I guess I can say, that I have ever done has been over the last 14 years. When my Kathy had her aneurysm rupture, and I found it necessary to care for her 24 hours a day. And you have been so gracious in the last 24 years by cutting me slack and allowing me time off and allow me to bring her to work with me every day and put her on the sofa. And my secretaries over that period of time and take care of her while I'm out on calls and so forth. But all of a sudden, I realize that I can't continue being your pastor and giving her the 100% care that she needs. I have promised her that I will never, ever, ever put her in a nursing home. That I will never, ever require someone else to clean her and to feed her and do those things. I'm going to do that. I made a commitment 43 years ago. When I married her, to take care of her till death do us part. And I know that if it were reversed and I were the one that had the brain aneurysm, she'd be doing the same for me. And so anyhow, thank you. And I thank the board that decided, I'm not 65 yet. I'm only 63 next month. And so I still need 2 more years of financial assistance. Actually, insurance until I can get Medicare and my retirement, 2 more years before I can draw on it. But fortunately, I have some other income that will help, and the church has agreed to kind of keep me around and help me and for the next 2 years. But you know, let me tell you something else. On that night when the car wouldn't start, and it started and everything worked out, and I felt God say, boy, I got this. You're going to be okay. In those 40 years of ministry, something happened here 5 years ago that was the toughest experience of all those 40 years. The church had a big, big split. It was a mess. And I reached the lowest point as a pastor in my 40 years, 5 years ago. And all of a sudden, we needed somebody to lead the worship and play. And God said, I got this. I got this. And there was a young man named Jordan James that he sent, an old Baptist boy. And boy, God's got this. He could not have brought a more perfect person for this situation. And I am unable to leave. I'm able to leave and to do what I need to do because God sent this man. And he and I have such a relationship. You know, it is an understood rule. The pastor never remains. When he resigns or retires, he takes off. You just don't do that. He and I know that it will work. I'm going to assist him as he needs me. I'll be there as he needs me. But this is what you need to know. I will never, ever, ever say anything negative about him. I will support him 100%. And I will no longer be your pastor. So you cannot come to me for things that you go to a pastor for. He's your pastor. And I also want to say this. If you ever dislike anything he's doing, you're not pleased with anything, and that'll always be Jordan. I'm sorry to tell you. For many, many years, I dreaded Monday mornings because there was always somebody coming to the office. Then what they didn't like, I said in my sermon or whatever. But you cannot ever, ever come to me to talk about Jordan or anything you dislike. The moment you do, I'm going to embarrass you. I'm going to say, hold on a second. I need to call Jordan so he can come and sit here with us. Since, I mean, you're wanting to talk about him. He needs to hear what you have to say. Please, I thank you, God, and for bringing that man and his beautiful family. Aren't you glad the Lord did that? And I'm grateful. My district superintendent has, I think, given his blessing on all of this. Haven't you, sir? Thank you. All right. I didn't even look at the notes. Let me see if I forgot something I was supposed to tell you. Yeah, but I can skip that. You don't want to hear that. That's all right. And this morning, I'm just going to preach like I always preach. I'm going to continue with the Gospel of John. We're finishing chapter 8 today. And stand, if you will, for the reading of God's Word. Jordan?
John 8, 48 through 59. The Jews answered him, aren't we right in saying that you are a Samaritan and demon-possessed? I am not possessed by a demon, said Jesus, but I honor my Father, and you dishonor me. I am not seeking glory for myself, but there is one who seeks it, and he is the judge. Very truly, I tell you, whoever obeys my word will never see death. At this they exclaimed, now we know that you were demon-possessed. Abraham died, and so did the prophets, yet you say that whoever obeys your word will never taste death. Are you greater than our father Abraham? He died, and so did the prophets. Who do you think you are? Jesus replied, if I glorify myself, my glory means nothing. My Father, whom you claim as your God, is the one who glorifies me. Though you do not know him, I know him. If I said I did not, I would be a liar like you, but I do know him and obey his word. Your father Abraham rejoiced at the thought of seeing my day. He saw it and was glad. You are not yet 50 years old, they said to him, and you have seen Abraham? Very truly I tell you, Jesus answered, before Abraham was born, I am. At this they picked up stones to stone him, but Jesus hid himself, slipping away from the temple grounds. You may be seated.
Again, thanks for being here this morning. I got my phone started going off text after text after text this morning. I knew something was up because a lot of folks were texting me and saying, it's Memorial Day weekend, we're out of town, I won't be there the Sunday today, I'm sorry. Anyhow, that gave me a clue that something's going on, and I hear, and I'm so excited about it, I hear we're having Popeye's chicken after the service this morning. Did I ever tell you guys I love Popeye's chicken? It's my favorite. That is my favorite. In this Gospel of John that we're going through verse by verse, we have noticed ever since chapter 2 that Jesus has been under attack. I mean, they came after him relentlessly. And the interesting thing about the attacks is that they did not come from the outside. It was from within Judaism, among the religious, the so-called people of God, that the unrelenting assaults kept coming against the Lord. And of course, this was as it always is, by design of Satan. You know, I was thinking in my 40 years of pastoral ministry, I cannot think of a single time when any attacks came at me from outside the church. The attacks, the name-calling, the attempts to discredit me, to undermine my efforts, to destroy my ministry, my church, always came from within the church. And often it was from people who had been born to a Christian family, raised within the church. It was so confusing. It was also always heartbreaking. Well, as we begin our study for today, these Jewish leaders had just heard Jesus say that they were of their father, the devil. He told them that they desired what the devil desires, and that is to lie and to destroy, to kill. Look at how they responded to Jesus in verse 48. The Jews answered him, aren't we right in saying that you are a Samaritan and a demon-possessed person? Now, what we've been witnessing here between these Jews and Jesus is what I would call a classical debate, if you will. We've all engaged in debates, haven't we? And debates, disagreements, usually start at an intellectual level. You state your position on a matter, the other person states his and explains why he disagrees with you. This is the healthy part of a debate or disagreement. But when the debate begins to break down is when it moves to the second level. I'm talking about the emotional level. Someone gets angry, usually the one who's losing the debate. And then he often takes it to the third level called the verbal level. That's when he begins to perhaps disparage you, call you names, insult you. And that's what the Jews were doing right here in verse 8. They called Jesus a demon-possessed person. And then debate sometimes the sins into a fourth level, and that is the physical level. That's when it leads to blows, to a fight. And you'll see where this debate reaches that level down in verse 59. So again, there are generally four levels of debate. It starts at the intellectual level, moves to the emotional level, progresses to the verbal level, and sometimes, unfortunately, winds up at the physical level. That's when you begin kicking booty often. Jesus had destroyed them intellectually. Then they got angry. And here they called him a Samaritan and demon-possessed. Calling him demon-possessed wasn't something new. They had done that numerous times already, and they would continue to do so. But why did they call him a Samaritan? Well, Samaritans were people that the Jews hated. Absolutely hated. In the Old Testament book of 2 Kings, we see where the northern kingdom of Israel was taken captive in 722 BC by the Assyrians. Most of the Jews from the northern kingdom were deported from the land. However, there were some that stayed. And those who stayed wound up marrying pagans. They came to occupy the land, so the offspring of these people became known as half-breeds, half-Jewish, half-pagan, and they were called Samaritans. Now, the reason they were called Samaritans is because the capital of the area was Samaria. So ever since 722 BC, the Jews had absolutely no dealings with the Samaritans, none. They were despised. They were hated. They were the worst of the worst. I mean, they were considered lower than the common Gentile. Jews would not even set foot on Samaritan soil. And if you really wanted to insult someone, what you did was you called them a Samaritan. And so this is what they called Jesus. They were into name calling, since they couldn't win the debate on the merits of who was a true child of Abraham. If you've been here, you know how this debate had been going. Look at how the Lord responded. "I'm not possessed by a demon," said Jesus, "but I honor my Father, and you dishonor me." And Jesus did not return the name-calling. You might say, well, Ken, he had called them, told them that their father was the devil. Well, that was a spiritual truth. That was a name calling. Jesus was not into verbally abusing people. In fact, in 1 Peter 2:23, it says, when he was reviled, verbally abused, he did not revile in return. He didn't retaliate. But he does point out that when they dishonored him, they were also dishonoring God. He went on to say, "I'm not seeking glory for myself, but there's one who seeks it, and he is the judge." Now, when Jesus said that he was not seeking glory for himself, he was saying that he came to earth in humiliation. He gave up his glory. In Philippians 2, it says that he set aside his glory. And throughout his ministry, he would repeat that he did not come to seek glory for himself. And in fact, he set aside his glory. He always claimed that he was seeking glory for the Father. And this was the essence of the incarnation, was it not? He came to give glory to God. And that's why just before his crucifixion, in his prayer, he said, "Father, I finished the work that you gave me. Now restore me to the glory I had with you before the world began." He went on, "Very truly, I tell you, whoever obeys my word will never see death." At this they exclaimed, "Now we know that you're demon-possessed. Abraham died, so did the prophets. Yet you say that whoever obeys your word is never going to taste death. Are you greater than our father Abraham? He died, so did the prophets. Who do you think you are?" Now, this is quite a statement by the Lord. It was a stunning statement for them. It should be a stunning statement for us as well. Obey my word, obey my teaching, and you'll never see death. Now, obviously, he wasn't talking about physical death because Jesus himself died. He was talking about what Revelation 20 calls the second death. He was talking about spiritual death. He was talking about eternal death. The believer's soul will never, never die, he said. Numerous times over the last 40 years of ministry, especially when I served as a chaplain in a downtown New Orleans hospital for a number of years while I was pastoring there, when people were on the verge of death, when they knew they were dying, so many times I would have them ask me, what is the experience going to be like when I die? Most people fear the experience of death, if not everyone. Well, I'd say, I have never obviously died, so I can't tell you personally what it's going to be like. However, I said, I had an experience that I believe is going to be very, very similar to death. In my life, I've had 4 or 5 surgeries, whereas I underwent anesthesia and was put to sleep. And I can remember in every one of those cases, when they said they were going to inject me and put me to sleep, I said, "I'm going to stay awake as long as I can. I want to see how long I can stay awake." I mean, doesn't that sound like me? That's what I do. But in every case, I don't remember anything after the injection except calm and peace. I'd go off to sleep. And when I woke up, I was amazed that the surgery had already ended. I didn't even know it had started. It was a surreal experience. You've been there. And that's how I understand from Scripture how death will be. I will simply go to sleep, nervously, not sure of what's going to happen or what it's going to feel like, but I'll awaken with calm and peace and joy that it's over. Can you imagine going to sleep and awaking in heaven? Now, just as all unbelievers are clueless, completely clueless about spiritual things, these Jews were clueless about the matter of dying. They responded to Jesus by saying, "Now we know you're demon-possessed. Are you greater than Abraham? Even he died. All the prophets have died. So who in the world do you think you are?" Jesus replied, "If I glorify myself, my glory means nothing. My Father, whom you claim as your God, is the one that glorifies me." Now, in all likelihood, this is what Jesus meant here. that his claims to deity meant nothing to them, obviously. They didn't believe anything he said. However, God the Father had already made it known as to his deity. These Jews were claiming to believe in God, but apparently they didn't really believe, since they never were even willing to accept the Lord's words. But you see, even at the Lord's baptism, God the Father exclaimed in a voice, "This is my beloved Son." God also made the Lord's identity known through a myriad of Old Testament prophecies. They didn't believe, though, so they could not believe. Jesus continued, "Though you don't know him, I know him. If I said I didn't, I'd be a liar like you, but I do know him and obey his words." Jesus said, "I know God. You don't know him. And if I agreed with your estimate that I don't know God, then I would be a liar just like you." But Jesus wasn't going to do that. He was truth. He was the epitome of truth, of course. And then he said this, "Your father Abraham rejoiced at the thought of seeing my day. He saw it and he was glad." Now, I won't go into all the details of what that meant, because I told you last week, we covered that. These Jews were always talking about their ancestral father, Abraham. Well, Abraham himself was given a messianic promise. In Genesis 12, he was told that through his family, God would bless the world through his seed, Abraham's seed. And that seed would bring salvation. And this was the Abrahamic covenant, folks. And Abraham believed it. Scripture says that Abraham believed God, and it was accounted to him for righteousness. He looked ahead in time, and he saw the arrival of Jesus. He saw it, and he was glad. That's what Jesus says here. So Jesus said, Abraham rejoiced at the thought of seeing my day. He saw it and he was glad. Yet they wouldn't believe. They wouldn't believe. I mean, they may have been physical descendants of Abraham, but as Jesus has already told them, they were spiritual descendants of his. They weren't children of God. Indeed, they were children of the devil. Now look at how these dummies responded to that. "You're not yet 50 years old, and you've seen Abraham." Now, I think a question mark belongs there. You've seen Abraham? That's what they're asking. You've seen Abraham? I think this was sarcasm. How would you know what Abraham saw and what brought him joy? And then, as we reach the conclusion, Jesus answers them with a most shocking statement. And you have to see this. Jesus said, "Very truly I tell you, before Abraham was born, I am." Wow. Jesus didn't say, "I was." He said, "I am." Because he's an eternal being, there is no was. He has always been. Before Abraham was born, I am. And I told you about the Tetragrammaton. Remember a few weeks ago, I went into detail giving you that. I am is the name of God. That's his name. And this statement that he was I am was absolutely more than these Jews could handle. They couldn't handle it. It was one thing for him to call them children of the devil, but for him to call himself I am, that was blasphemous. Absolutely blasphemous. In their debate, they had gone from the intellectual level, their reasoning, to the emotional level, their anger, to the verbal level, their name calling.
Now, look at this concluding verse. At this, they picked up stones to stone him. But Jesus hid himself, slipping away from the temple grounds. They moved to the physical level. They tried to kill him. But it wasn't time for him to die. Why? Because he was on a divine schedule. It was not going to come until the Father said so, until the time it had been eternally set. So it says that he slipped away from their presence.
You know what, folks? They never came to believe. They never came to believe. Lots of people are born into this world, live 80, 90 years, and never come to believe. What's going to be said of you in the end? Are you a believer? I don't mean repeated prayer. I don't mean went forward in a service. I'm saying, have you recognized that you reached the place that I am a sinner, separated from God, and I need to repent of that sin? I am sorry, God. I am sorry. And so now, from this moment on, I'm going to place my trust and my life into your hands.
If you've never done that, I hope you'll do that. In fact, I hope you'll do it right now as we pray. Stand with me if you would, please. Father in heaven, O God, what a joy to go through your word verse by verse and to see what is there. And Lord, I confess the hard part is not understanding it. The hard part is applying it, is living it. Help us. I pray, Lord, that if there is anyone here today who has not repented of their sin, trusted in you for their salvation, that they'll do so even this moment. Bless these folks, I ask, in the holy, holy name of Jesus. Amen. And I'm told that you're supposed to sit for a few minutes as your new pastor comes up here and takes over. You know what? That guy is a good boy. And I love him. God bless you.
He's going to be mad at me for what's coming next, though. Now, before we go and have his favorite meal, which, as you all know, is Popeye's fried chicken, I've got a couple of surprises, a few surprises. Of course, first and foremost, I'd like to ask our district superintendent, Billy Wilson, to come on stage real quick. Y'all give him a hand.
Thanks, Jordan. It is it's really an honor to be here and hear some of those stories firsthand. I've spent time on that campus. My four children have gone to Oklahoma Wesleyan, and my son now lives and works at Oklahoma Wesleyan, and his house is just on the other side of the fence. So anytime I go to visit him, I'm there, so I could visualize Bartlesville downtown, and listening to that story was just moving. It's funny how sometimes God allows us to experience adversity because we need to know He's there for what's to come next. And you've seen that in your ministry, Ken. And so I'm here today to honor you as a pastor, as a person, as a leader. You know, you can tell a good leader by what happens to an organization, to a church, after the leader's gone. And so when you told me that there was a transition coming, but that I didn't need to do anything, that it was taken care of, I was like, that's the man right there. Because I'll just tell you, I take care of about 65 churches in our district. And what usually happens, sadly enough, is a pastor just calls me and tells me, hey, I'm done. Good luck there. And then months of searching for a new leader ensues, and that's a difficult process, and that's a very important part of my job. So when a leader says, I have been raising up my successor for several years, and so you don't really need to do anything, you just need to kind of know what's happening. And it's not just any old leader, but it's a leader like Jordan. You need to know the kind of skill and commitment that took. Some of it by Ken's part. But what Ken had to do was just kind of listen and follow God's lead. And that's not always easy to do. So I just want to recognize that. I believe that the future of this church is very bright. I sat down just the other day and just made a list of all of our churches that I thought had great potential. And this church is on that short list, in part because of this foundation that your pastor has laid and the succession plan that you have in place. I hope you're as optimistic as I am about this place. So that's enough about this church. I want to talk about Ken for a minute. Ken, you were here when we sang a song about a crystal sea. And the crystal sea gives a little bit of a glimpse, just kind of piques our imagination of there is a future beyond this where our bodies don't give out, a future beyond this where we get to see our Savior face to face. And that the picture of a crystal sea just sort of gives our imagination something to play with. And so today I want to give you a little bit of a down payment on the crystal. So I brought a piece of crystal of my own. So would you just come up, Ken? I want to give this to you in front of those who love you the most. Ken, you, surprisingly enough, have been in service to the Western Church for 45 years. I had to double check that. I didn't believe it. I asked my wife, I said, how long has Ken been? And she showed me in the Wesleyan portal, 45 years. And then I went and looked at some of the pictures in where you're going to have chicken. And yeah, you actually are that old. And those are some old pictures. But this is a piece of crystal that hopefully will remind you of the crystal sea that you'll get to walk around someday. When Jesus had to answer his accusers, the answer that you preached about was that I honor my Father. And so Ken, I just want to say that you have done great honor to your Heavenly Father, to your Savior, and to the Wesleyan Church. And we would like to return just a small token of our appreciation for that by honoring you today. What this says is 45 years of service presented to Reverend Kenneth Satcher. From the Mount Plains District of the Wesleyan Church, with deep appreciation for your faithful service as planter and pastor, May 30, 2021. Ken, I'm honored to be a colleague of yours. I'm honored to serve the Wesleyan Church beside you. And would you just accept deep appreciation from the Wesleyan Church that you've served so faithfully for so long? Thank you. Voice sounds a little different in this than yours does, Jordan. I don't know why. I think they do something back there in the back. She's manipulating that. I had a long conversation with your pastor when I heard what was about to go down, and I just said, now you realize how difficult this is for a pastor to stick around. And there was the way Jordan talked about, yeah, I know. And the way Ken talked about it, yeah, we know. This is kind of funky. This is kind of weird. But as we talked through it, it just felt right. It just felt like this is the way it's supposed to be. So to answer Ken's question, my full approval, endorsement of this whole thing, believe strongly in what's about to happen here. Jordan, God bless you.
Give Billy another hand. Now, whenever I was talking to Billy earlier, and I was kind of going over how we would do this here at the end of the service, I said, you know, I said, well, there's probably going to be some crying a little bit. I said, so I'm going to let you do the happy part first. But then I thought about it again, and the second person that I'm going to ask to come up here, as one of my first decisions as pastor, I'm a little nervous about. But this is someone who has been as close to kin as any of us, and who spent 20 years as his employee. So she's earned her stars in heaven. Y'all give a hand to Miss Laura.
Jordan's first decision was a poor one. Good morning. I was Ken's secretary for almost 20 years. The longest period anyone had ever worked for him was 2. And I wasn't good at it. It's not why I was here 20 years. I'm just meaner than he is. And in those years, we really were a great team. I had the opportunity to grow in Christ. He's an excellent teacher. I became inspired to become a counselor myself, watching the way he loved and cared for others, especially his congregation, and of course, my best friend, Kathy. Ken has what's called empathy. Not everyone possesses empathy. Empathy is the ability to understand what others feel, to see things from their point of view, to imagine yourself in their place. You're able to put yourself in someone else's position and feel what they feel. For almost 20 years, I watched him be the epitome of empathy. When his congregation hurt, he hurt. When they were at their lowest, he was right there beside them. And when people left the church because they were upset or angry, this hurt him incredibly deeply. It has been an honor to be a part of your ministry and your career. And what a great career you've had. You've been a blessing and led so many people to Christ, including myself, my son. Congratulations on the job. Very well done, my friend.
And one last thing. And then we'll be done, and y'all can go eat Popeye's fried chicken, and Ken can punch me in the throat later. You want to dim the light? Got a little video. See if you can dim the house lights, too. It's a little button on the bottom right. It's red. There you go. Go ahead.
I'm Ken Sanger, pastor of Live Oak Community Church.
Hey, Ken, It's my privilege to be able to celebrate you today, old buddy. And I just want you to know how much you have meant to me, both as a friend and as a colleague and fellow minister. It was my absolute privilege to follow you in Kenner, Louisiana. And you can always tell a lot about a leader and a person, a pastor, by the people that he leads. And I got to lead some of those same people that you led to the Lord, that you grew up in the faith, and the way they respected you and the kind of disciple they were tells what kind of person you were. And the thing I remember about following you is that you were always so complimentary of me, so encouraging towards me, and it can be hard to follow some people, but you were always just there for me and were always my biggest cheerleader, and I appreciate that so much about you. You know, in Scripture, one of the things you look at is the overarching theme of who we are to be as Christians is the great commandment, loving God and loving people. And frankly, I don't know anybody else in this world who exhibits those two things. You absolutely love God with all your heart, mind, soul, strength. That's always been so evident. Your pure, passionate love for God. And then your love of people. I don't know anybody who loves people the way that you love people. And so you've just been a great role model for me. I love the time that we've gotten to serve together. And so once again, just thank you for your service to the kingdom. Thank you for the service to our district. It was my privilege to be able to be your district superintendent for those years. And man, I just continue to pray for you. And I can't wait to spend time out on the golf course with you in the very near future. You are loved. I love you. And just thank you for your service to the kingdom, buddy. Talk to you soon.
Little things that you have done, made, the list here on earth, in heaven and now proclaim. Listen, I know up in heaven, you're not supposed to cry, but I am almost sure I saw tears in your eyes when Jesus took your hand and you stood before the Lord. He sent my child around you, for great is your reward.
Spiritual kingdom, and all are who belong to him through faith in his gospel. He's our great high priest who ever lives to make intercession for us. He hears and answers our prayers, and he gives us things consistent with his will and his promise for blessed people.
Can't describe how thankful I am for you. You've been not only my pastor and my mentor, but you've been my friend. And I owe you a great debt for that. I think I can speak on behalf of everyone at Live Oak Community Church that we're thankful to have had a leader and a shepherd like you. My greatest hope and prayer is that God will allow me to do half of what you've done in your ministry. I love you, baby. Thank you for everything.
Such a great community around you. Ever since I was little, when I would go to Louisiana, I looked forward to two things, my papa's pool and my papa's church. Visiting my papa and seeing the church that he built and the people around him was so fulfilling to me, and seeing the passion that he has for this church has really inspired me, and I couldn't ask for a better role model. Thank you, Papa, and good job, and go Tigers!
My favorite man of the cloth, the mighty Reverend Kenneth Earl Satcher. I'm proud of you, Dad. I'm so proud of you. And I'm proud of Mom. I'm grateful and I'm so thankful that I had you two as parents and that I grew up the way that I did. I know I was a horrible teenager, we don't need to think about that, but now that I'm an adult and a mother and a Christian, I realized how blessed I was to have such incredible parents that gave their entire life to follow Christ and to do his work. And not everyone can say that. You make me proud. You make me very proud. So proud, and I'm proud to be your daughter. I'm very happy for you. This is very bittersweet. You couldn't have done this without Mom. And I kept thinking about that. The whole time, I just keep having these memories of how supportive Mom was and how she was, you know, always in the background and would talk to you and kind of go through this. People don't always realize it's not always easy being a pastor. Humans are horrible. And they're not always nice. But you always managed to show God's love. And you really did it the way that Jesus intended You are the most genuine man I've ever known in my life. You are the best man I've ever known, and you were obviously, obviously meant to do this, and you followed your calling. And I keep thinking of that saying that behind every great man is an even greater woman. And you two are an amazing team. I'm so proud of you. I'm happy, can't wait to see you. And now you can move here.
Anxiety and pressure and fear and worry that's produced by those kinds of things. People are always looking to the future. We believe it's going to get better. It's going to get better. We have hope. I don't care how bad it is right now, personally or for my family. We believe it's going to get better. If you don't think it is, you are the beginning. You need help. You need some help. See someone. Despair is the worst thing in the world. But you all think it's going to be better, don't you? I do.
If you will, please stand. May the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Let's go eat some chicken before Kim beats me up.
Why I didn't even wear makeup. I'm like, I'm just going to cry the whole time.
You have to run.